All right, Hope Church, how we feel this morning? Come on, can we shout? Yeah. Well, hey, we're excited you guys are here. You guys excited to be at the Marquee this morning? Can we give it up for the Marquee? Hey, it's going to be great. We're about to go into a time of praise and worship. We just ask guys that you keep your mask on at all times while you're here. But we're going to get rowdy. We're going to rap. We're going to sing. We're going to jump around and dance. Is that okay? It's going to be fun. This first song requires a little bit of clapping, jumping around. So, and then the second song and the third song require too, but it's going to be good. Here's this first one.
Be on key, but it's from my heart. and no one else can tell it. What the Lord has done for me. This might take all day, so I better stop right now. And it might get loud. It might get loud. Heaven's coming down, down, down. And it might get loud. It might get loud. Heaven's coming down, down, down. And it might get loud. I don't have a halo. No, I'm not a perfect man. And I'm just glad to be a child of God. When I think of where I could have been, should have been, would have been if you hadn't said it. And I got a praise on the inside that can't be denied. And I gotta get it out right now. It might get loud. It might get loud. Heaven's coming down, down, down. And it might get loud. It might get loud. Heaven's coming down, down, down. And it might get loud. It might get loud. Heaven's coming down, down, down. And it might get loud. Sweat, see the beat, yeah, yeah, use my lungs, exhaling on the beat, yeah, yeah, ought to give it up the pot, yeah, 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 y'all can't tell me nothing, my God gave me something, oh no, did you see something, can't hear your own brother come, my God gave me something, y'all can't tell me nothing. You say something, can't hear your own brother coming.
Why can't I praise in this loud and so hard? Why can't I praise him as loud as I want? Why can't I praise him as loud as I want? Why can't I praise him as loud as I want? Why can't I praise him as loud as I want? Why can't I praise him as loud as I want? Why can't I praise him as loud as I want? Why can't I praise him as loud as I want?
Pray with us going into this last song. Lord Jesus, Father God, we just say, Holy Spirit, come and fill this place right now. Father God, we thank you that on a Sunday morning we can come together. We can praise the name of Jesus. We can clap our hands. We can jump. We can sing. God, and it's about lifting up the name of your Son, Jesus, for what he did on the cross. So I thank you that worship can be an expression of gratitude. It can be an expression of surrender, God. When things in our lives are crazy or there's so many distractions, we can just choose any moment of time, but especially right now, to focus on you. To just say, Holy Spirit, come. Fill my life, fill my heart. So I just ask God in this next song that your Holy Spirit would continue to be in this place, would minister to us, would speak to us, that our hearts would be open for the preaching of the word. In Jesus' name, everybody say, amen. Come on. Let's clap for the Lord. All right, we have one more for you guys today. Just want to encourage you guys, if you feel comfortable in this last song, just to lift your hands as a sign of surrender. We're going to lift up the name of Jesus.
Revival, Lord, send it now. Move of your spirit. For the words of that song. God, we thank you for the message. It's just so much deeper than even the lyrics of music or the lyrics of the song, God. But we thank you that what we can do when we ask for a revival first in our own hearts is just trust you that you will show up, God, that you hear our prayers. God, that we're not just crying out to a dead God or an ancient artifact, God, but you want a relationship with us. You're a loving Father that's real today. You're as real as ever. So we thank you for what you've done in worship. We thank you what you're going to do today. We just say, Holy Spirit, come again. We pray that we'd be at the front of our seats, leaning in and listening, and that we'd hear and obey. In Jesus' name, everybody say, amen. Can we shout one more time? All right, everybody. Well, hey, welcome to Hope Church again. Kids are now dismissed to help kids. We're going to get moving with our service shortly, so welcome.
Thank you. growing up, I was raised in a Christian household, and I came to know who Christ was and how to have a relationship with him when I was 5 years old. It wasn't until high school that I really learned to stop living for myself and to really own my faith. I got connected to Hope a couple weeks before my freshman year, and immediately I met some girls there and just felt so welcome. I loved Connect Groups because it really challenged me to not have my guard up and to really learn like how to grow deeper in relationships with others. And when we do that, other people get to pour into my life and help me grow with stuff that I'm struggling with. As I started attending Hope, I started to notice a pattern in my life of making decisions out of fear. I really struggled with fear of man and fear of rejection. And what was cool is I had amazing friends that helped point that out to me. And that was when I like realized that God didn't want me to fear the world. God wanted me to be able to conquer the world knowing that I had him behind me. And so I got to repent for that. Now when fear does come up again and anxiety does come up again, I get to be reminded that God actually is my protector and that he wants to give me security in my life, and I no longer have to be controlled by fear and anxiety. Sharing with others what Jesus has done in my life is so important to me, because if someone else hadn't slowed down with me to share with me how God had brought them freedom from fear and anxiety, I honestly would probably still be stuck today. It's so amazing that God actually doesn't want us to live life alone, that he wants us to live life with others and to be in community with others. So I'm just really excited as a resident to see how God still has a mission for our lives, even if our context changes from being solely on campus to being on campus and in the city, getting to have the opportunity to reach other people that no one else gets to see. I have to invite people to be a part of what we're doing because it's so amazing and life-changing. My name is Madison, and I'm a campus changer and a city changer.
What's up, everybody? How's everyone doing? Yeah. So good morning, everyone. Welcome to Hope Church. My name's Connor, and I'm a campus missionary here at Hope.
And I'm Alexis. I'm also a campus missionary. We're both on the outreach team in Tucson.
Come on. Yeah. Let's
go. So shout out to all my Wildcats watching today.
So we got some announcements for you guys. But first, we want to honor this week's campus changer, Madison. Where's Madison at?
Maddie. Right.
Oh, back there.
Yes. Maddie, Give it up. Maddie, I loved hearing about how God just moved in your life in the area of fear and how now you want to go and share that with other girls, and just because that's what someone did for you. You are a campus and a city changer. Let's give it up for her one more time.
Come on. So as we continue with our service, we want to take up our offering. Thank you so much to everyone who gives financially here at Hope. Like you heard in Madison's story, your giving is impacting lives for eternity.
And today we want to highlight our guest speaker fund. This fund allows us to be a blessing to the guests who come and speak at our church. So please consider giving generously. You can give online by going to our website. And remember, this isn't parents' money or scholarship money, but money you earn from a job.
Sweet. So all right, everyone. I hope you all been coming up with your best costume ideas, because this Saturday night, all tribes are hosting costume parties. Let's go. So talk to your Connect Group leader to get more details and invite all your friends out.
Yes, and next Sunday is Baptism Sunday. Mm-hmm. Yes, next Sunday is Baptism Sunday.
Yeah.
So if you're interested in learning more about water baptism, talk to your Connect Group leader about getting into one of our Gradebook Bible studies.
So that's it for this week's announcements, guys. As we continue with service, let's check out the video.
How's everybody doing? So glad you're with us today and with us online, live streaming to other cities. How about Flagstaff at NAU? Let's give it up for them. How about UNLV in Las Vegas? Let's give it up for them. And all our friends online, we're glad you're with us. Hey, we've been doing this series, Living the Dream, What's Stopping You? And we're really looking at the difference between living our dream, what we can come up with, and then living God's dream, what is Word reveals about him and what his dream is for mankind, and really us specifically too. And so I hope this is helping. Is this helping anybody, this series? I know it's helping me. You know, when you have to prepare for something like this, it helps you. And so we're glad. Listen, you could be a lot of places today. We're glad you chose to be with us at Hope Church, and we hope that you're blessed today. I want to introduce a hero of the faith in just a minute. And it's an incredible privilege today to have him with us. I'll tell you a little bit about him in a minute. But before we get going, I want to recognize our new members. We have 23 new members across our site. Praise God. We put together a little slideshow. Check this out. Yes, new members. Hey, if you're a new member, would you stand up here and at our other sites? Would you do that, please? We want to pray for you. Come on, stand up. Give them a hand. Yeah. Way to go, man. Well, listen, let's pray for these new members. You can stretch out your hand of faith if you're near them. If you're really close, you can put your hand on their shoulder in an appropriate way. And don't pull them down. Don't tickle them. All right, let's pray for these new members. Lord, thank you for your word. It says in 1 Corinthians 12:18 that God has placed the members in the body as he chooses, as he desired. And Lord, we believe you've placed these members in this local church body, the place where you desire. And so we receive them as members of this local family, this local church family. And we commit to them to see God's will done in their life as it is in heaven. Lord, we pray that we could be an encouragement, that we could know them, we could love them, we could challenge them to take the next step when they need a challenge. And Lord, we just welcome them in and pray that they would even sense a difference in the atmosphere around their lives this week because they've taken a step of obedience. Lord, your word calls us to not forsake the assembling, and that you place us in a body. And when you place us, it's our choice to respond. And these have responded, and we welcome them in. We pray that they would have a tremendous journey with us as long as you would have them in our body, in this local church body. We're going to love them and hopefully see your will done in their lives. So, Lord, we pray for your presence to be on them in a greater way moving forward because of this decision. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Come on, one more hand. Little bit about our guest speaker now. I'm so excited to introduce him. He is not only a fisherman, and by the way, he caught a rainbow trout that was 19 inches long and 2.5 pounds. Anybody fishermen out there, they yelled because they know how big that is, okay? So maybe he'll tell us a little bit about that. But our speaker today is not only a fisherman, he's a fisher of men. He's literally traveled over 100 university campuses. He has a master's in biblical studies from Dallas Theological Seminary and a doctorate of ministry from Denver Seminary. He's authored 6 books, including The Fuel and the Flame, which is a book I highly recommend, The Fuel and the Flame. We are going to be selling those at the book table afterwards. He's the founder of Student Mobilization, also known as STUMO, which is reaching college students on over 1,000 campuses. Did you hear that? 1,000. You thought ASU was big. 1,000, okay? Campuses. All right, anyway. He currently serves as the global ambassador for the Center of Mission Mobilization. He and his wife, Carol, have been married for 38 years. They have 5 children and 8 grandchildren. All that being said, here's what I appreciate about Steve Shadrach. Steve and I share the same passion to reach the next generation of students. You're going to hear it come out of him. He absolutely loves college students. He's been doing this for over 40 years. He's just, you can't get him off the campus. He loves being with college students. What a privilege to have him today. You know, earlier this year, I did a podcast with him and Paul Wooster on campus ministry today. And so you can look that up. You can look up a bunch of great resources if you want to learn about how to do campus ministry better, how to be assimilated into a church or a campus ministry, how to really make the most of your college career. But I encourage all of us to subscribe to that podcast as well. So here's the deal. For over 4 decades, Steve has absolutely laid down his life to connect with, clarify the gospel, and really lay down his life for college students. And so it is just a joy. Would you guys give him the loudest hope welcome we could, Pastor Steve Shadrach?
Thank you.
There you go. We're sharing this, aren't we? There you go.
I have the golden tablet here. Dang, I was hoping you'd still be kind of the mosh pit up here, and I was going to dive over and see if y'all would surf me along, you know, and can we still do that? Yes? No? No, no, I don't think I want to risk it. But great to have everybody here today. What a cool venue you guys have. I love it, and I love being here with you. So what a great campus. I was on Arizona State campus on Friday, and 80,000 students. That just, I kind of salivate when I think about that, you know. Like a dog or something, right? That's not a good picture, is it? But just the potential of what God is doing and can do through that campus to not only touch the city and this state, but the world. And so I know that's on your heart as well. So thank you for having me. I wanted to introduce my family here. I know there's a picture of them somewhere. There they are. I hired a bunch of models, you know, to stand in that picture with me. No, my wife of 38 years is there. And then like Pastor Brian said, we have 5 kids and 8 grandkids, but we've just begun to get started on the grandkids. You know, if I'd known it was that fun, I would have skipped the kid stage, gone straight to the grandkid stage. You know, there are a lot of verses in the Bible I haven't done real well with. How about you? But the one about be fruitful and multiply, I think we're doing okay, right? So, anyway, I live in Fayetteville, Arkansas, and if you've ever been there, that's home of the Arkansas. Well, thank you so much. That just makes me feel good. And we've always lived next to the campus. I don't try this yourself, but we've always, you know, lived next to the campus, having students live with us, and so that's been part of my life and our lives so much. But I grew up in Dallas in a very great family. It was a moral family, a church-going family, and of course, I thought I was a Christian. Most people in the South, you know, we think we're Christians. You got to work hard to get us lost before you can ever truly get us saved, because we all think we're saved. I mean, I had a mother. I had a Bible. I went to church. I was an officer in FCA, Pastor. I mean, come on. Doesn't that count for something? I wasn't a Buddhist. I mean, you know, I mean, I thought I was a Christian. Until a guy with Athletes in Action, if you know that ministry, he had been assigned to Dallas to work with high school athletes. And someone had said I was a Christian athlete. So he called me and contacted me, and we got together. Well, he soon realized that I was not a Christian, and most people didn't think I was much of an athlete. And so, you know, 0 for 2 on that count, right? But he decided I needed to learn how to share my faith. And so he took me to an airport there in Dallas, and he went first. And all I was supposed to do was just write the guy's name down. He was a military, you know, a soldier. And Alan shared this little gospel booklet with him. And I was shaking so badly, friends, I could not even write his name down. Alan had to take the pen and, you know, do that for me. But now it's my turn. Oh, my word. It's my turn to now find someone in that airport that I'm supposed to share with. I found the safest person I could possibly find, a 15-year-old kid sitting there, you know, watching TV. And so I came up to him and introduced myself and started reading this little booklet to him, and it just was a total disaster. I mean, his brothers came up and started jostling us, and the officials came up and saying, you can't solicit here, you know, and stuff. And you know what I realized, though, as I was taking him through that little booklet, was that I had never even made that decision. It was humbling to admit that. It was my pride just was shattered. And I realized I had never made that decision. So it was that afternoon there in my living room that my friend Alan led me to Christ. For the first time ever, I put my trust, my faith, my hope into Jesus Christ as my Savior, as my Lord. And my, yes. And really, my life began to change, radically change. And so really, that's kind of an idea for you. If you want to lead someone to Christ, take them out on evangelism. And when they're sharing the gospel, boom, the Holy Spirit just goes right in there. So you want to try that? I don't know. But anyway, it made a big difference in my life. I enrolled in the University of Arkansas that next fall and wasn't planning on joining a fraternity. But within a week, I was moving into one of the big, bad fraternity houses, you know, on this state campus, and lived there for 3 years. And I just saw God change my life and change the lives of my fraternity brothers, so much so that I said, you know what? I want to do this the rest of my life. You know, there's some good addictions and bad addictions, right? And so let's focus on the good ones. Seeing Jesus Christ transform someone's life, you see that happen one time, friends, you're hooked, you're sunk, it's over. You want to spend the rest of your life doing that. And so I love it that this is a lot of college students here. I guess you could call it a collegiate church. I know some of you are not college students, but I see a lot of young faces out there. And I had a good college experience. My GPA wasn't that great. I'm not even sure I had one. I did okay in most courses, unless they had to do with words or numbers. Everything else was a struggle. But anyway, it's good to be with you today. I'm honored to be here. And I love the series you're in, Living the Dream. Oh, my word. I love that. When I heard about it, though, I couldn't help but think about one of my favorite TV shows. Does anybody here in the crowd remember I Dream of Jeannie, the TV show? Okay. That was probably the most risque show in the, you know, in the whole history of our country at that point, right? But then one of my favorite movies, the more recent, I know some of you have seen this. It was Field of Dreams, right, with Kevin Costner. Had to watch that two or three times to understand that one. But man, what a cool one. And you remember how he is allowed to see and talk and experience his long-deceased father in that movie? Do you remember that? And it was a team of baseball players, and he was the only one that could see that. And in a sense, he was living the dream, wasn't he? Even though most people thought he lost his mind. And so anyway, this is a cool series that you're in. And if you really start to embrace these truths that Pastor Brian and others are sharing with you about living the dream, I think it's going to really change your life. And so I want to continue with that this morning, if that's okay. I kind of want to add on, and we're going to look at another blockade to keep you from living the dream. And not your dream, of course. It's God's dream that we're going after, isn't it? And so, you know, you may also have folks, as you start to embrace God's dream, that think you're weird, that think you're strange, that think you're fanatical, that think you are a little bit off, right? You will be swimming upstream your whole life, friends. If you choose God's way, just know you're going to be swimming upstream, especially right now in our country, in our culture. It is a challenge. And so you will have inexpressible joy and purpose, though, but also that opposition and rejection. Jesus did, and you and I as well. So here's another way of expressing God's dream for your life. One of my favorite verses is John 10:10. And Jesus was talking here, and he says, "The thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly." Quite the contrast, isn't it? Friends, there's a battle going on for your soul. There's an intergalactic, may I use that word? Maybe I'm pulling that from Star Wars or something, right? But it's the clash of the titans. God and Satan are battling over your soul, and you have a choice. You can choose either what Satan wants to do to you. He wants to steal, kill, and destroy you. But now Jesus has this alternative, this option for you, a way out, an escape, an exciting plan for you. He says, "But I want to give you life, not just life, but abundant life, okay? And so in this one verse, it states what his dream is for you. And so I hope you choose wisely there, okay? But most people are not experiencing this abundant life. Would you say that's true on your campus? I mean, as you look around, they're not experiencing the abundant life that Jesus has for them. But he wasn't just talking about life in heaven someday, you know, salvation, you know, once you die in heaven there. It reminds me a little bit of Muhammad Ali, that great boxer. You know, he used to say something like this. He'd say, I don't want some pie in the sky when I die. I want something sound on the ground when I'm still around, you know. He always had those rhymes, you know. And so he wanted something worth living right now. Not just then, but right now. So what does that look like? Pastor Brian talked about living the dream, and he doesn't mean living whatever dream you come up with. You know, my kids now have me on Instagram, you know, and you got to be on Instagram, Dad. Well, you know, I'm learning all kinds of things on Instagram. And, you know, they tell you about, you know, how do you create your dream and your life and how you can become a billionaire and how you can have a six pack of abs, you know? And I mean, it's just that, you know, and so I, you know, boy, I'm looking, oh yeah, yeah, I'd like that. I'd like to have that six pack, you know? So it's the dream that God has for us. And so a little bit of review, God's dream, Pastor Brown was saying, is to have a family of sons and daughters. Hopefully that's you and I that are in relationship with him who reflect his character, but rule every area of our lives and reproduce physically, but also reproduce spiritually. I know you want to be married and have a family someday, but also focus on reproducing spiritually. And he started talking about these various blockades that keep us from living God's dream. One of them, I thought it was kind of interesting, and I hadn't necessarily heard this phrase before, but an orphan spirit. I thought that was pretty powerful, what he was sharing, which in what he was describing, it means we got to stop believing lies about our Heavenly Father. We have to allow God to adopt us into his family. We have to come into his home, the kingdom of heaven, and to live like sons and daughters of God. When I saw this, my heart leapt. I said, wow, this is really cool because it reminds me of one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. I hope you're taking notes this morning. Are you taking notes? In Arkansas, we really don't use pens. I mean, we just bite off the end of our fingers and use blood, you know, is what we do. Has anybody ever been to Arkansas? Anybody at all? I mean, why? Why did you go? What was the, you know? But you have to believe there's a lot of stereotypes there, right? I mean, the fact that I even have shoes on today, all right? And teeth. I got teeth, friends, okay, you know? And so feel free to, you know, create any stereotypes you want to, because some of them are true. But Ephesians 1, and I'm hoping you'll write that down because maybe tomorrow in your quiet time, it's the chapter I go to over and over and over again because it describes probably better than any chapter in the Bible who you are. If I were to ask you, who are you? You'd probably tell me your name. I said, I'm not asking your name. Who are you? Oh, well, I'm a college student. Now, I'm not asking you what your profession is or whatever. Who are you? Now you're getting real nervous. What does this guy want? You know, what are you asking? Well, I'm hoping that you will tie your identity to your Creator, not to anything else that this world has to offer, because we all are trying to find our self-confidence and self-esteem and self-image, aren't we, in the world and all that it has to offer, Instagram. And then my TikTok. I got a TikTok also, and man, do I do some amazing dances, you know, on TikTok. And no, I don't have a TikTok. I don't have TikTok. My twin granddaughters do. I'm a little concerned, though. So, anyway, Pastor Brian spent a lot of time in Genesis with you guys, but I want to start out with Ephesians 1, if I could. And so it tells you who you are. And if we could simply view ourselves the way God views us, isn't that the perfect self-image? I mean, they're telling us that we're really struggling with self-image here in our world today. A lot of that's because of social media. Where do you find the proper, healthy self-image, self-esteem, self-confidence? You can find it in Christ if you choose to, okay? If we will believe what God has said about us rather than the world or media has said about us. So Ephesians 1, it's early on there in verse 3, it says that God has given us every single spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Isn't that amazing? I don't feel like that sometimes. I mean, I'm just kind of here. You know, what do you mean spiritual blessing? Well, whether you believe it or feel it or not, it's a true fact. It's truth. God, if you're a believer here this morning, He has already blessed you with every single spiritual blessing. It's part of your possession. But then He goes and He unpacks it, friends. In that chapter, He starts unpacking those blessings. And listen to some of these blessings that you have as a believer. It belongs to you. Starting in verse 4, it says, God chose us. When? In Him, before the foundation of the world, He chose you, that we would be holy and blameless before Him. In love, He predestined us as adoption as sons, to adoption as sons through Christ Himself, according to the kind intention of His will. In Him, we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of His grace, which He, boy, I love this word. We don't use this word very often, do we? Which He lavished upon us. The word lavish just means abundantly, more than you could possibly ever need or use, or, you know, it's just like He just pours it out upon us. We all have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to His purpose, who works all things after the counsel of His will. And so in Him, you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in Him by the Holy Spirit of promise, who has given us a pledge of our inheritance with a view to the redemption of God's own possession, the praise of His glory. Didn't mean to read a whole chapter for you. But when you start to immerse your mind and your heart in that, if you start to focus on who you are in Christ, it will change you. It will change you. Start to view yourself as, I'm not a college student, I'm not an Arizonian, I'm not whatever titles you think you, personas you may have created, say, no, I am a child of God. Amen. That's who I am. That's my primary identity. Everything else is backseat, see. But then, Paul prays for you. He prays for you. Look at this in verse 18. He says, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you will know, not guess, but know what is the hope of His calling, what are the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints, and what is the surpassing greatness of His power toward us who believe. Isn't that cool? Your eyes have, your heart has eyes. He's praying that the eyes of your heart would be opened. Isn't that powerful? To these truths, that you'd embrace them. And so I quit measuring wealth, friends, in monetary terms years ago. Years ago. It says here you are a child of God and you fully inherit all that the Heavenly Father has for you. In fact, you own God's heavenly riches and He has given you and I a pledge, a down payment right now in this earth, on this earth, in this life, that promises us our full inheritance someday in heaven. Isn't that cool? It's pretty amazing, really. I mean, I don't feel it. I don't see it. I mean, and yet it's true. It's true. And so which of these blessings are most meaningful to you? Have you thought about that? As you meditate on these, maybe tomorrow morning in your quiet time, and you start to believe what God has said about you, what God has done for you, your life will change. As you quit looking at the condemning and shaming world around us, and fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of your faith, you will be changed. It reminds me of Romans 12, 1 and 2. I have to believe this is a verse that some of you have memorized. And Paul in Romans 12, 1 and 2 talks about, do not be conformed to this world. Remember that verse? Do not be conformed to this world, but be what? Transformed, that's right, by the renewing of your mind. That's how it happens, the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. Well, I'd put that one to memory if I were you. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Here's the bottom line, friends. If we quit focusing on what we don't have, instead focus on what we do have, we'll be happier, more fulfilled people who are experiencing this abundant life, living the dream. In other words, quit focusing on your current condition in this world, but rather your position in Christ. Okay? The struggles of this world, the inadequacies, the shame, the all the things that are trying to drag us down will start to fade and push away as we keep our eyes focused on Jesus Christ and who he is, what he's done for us, our position in Christ as sons and daughters of the King.
Let's go.
So, I know about orphans, Pastor. I do. I know about adoption. That first blockade was the orphan spirit. We spent a year in the country of Ukraine, our family did, in the mid-1990s. And afterwards, I went back to Ukraine to bring home a little bonus that we had been praying about, a little two-year-old girl in an orphanage there in eastern Ukraine. And I remember going to that orphanage, and the director of the orphanage put me in a room with two little girls. And she said, I'm going to come back in an hour. You tell me which of these girls you want me to adopt. You want to adopt. I couldn't believe it. You know, here I am talking, you know, the whole idea of predestination and God choosing one or not choosing the other. I mean, this will change forever change one of these girls' lives for me to adopt, right? And so I knew which one we were to adopt. You know, little Svetlana was her Russian name. We call her KK now. That's her American name. And I brought her home. She was a tiny little two-year-old at the time. And really, she was still only 19 pounds when she was 3.5 years old. Isn't that amazing? But as we incorporated in our family and started loving her and feeding her, I mean, she became the healthiest of all my kids. She became a champion gymnast in our part of the country, right? And so anyway, she's 27 years old now, and I've got a picture of her in my phone if any godly single guys would like to talk to me after the session here, you know. I'd like to possibly, Pastor, maybe interview a few, kind of your top three maybe, okay? She's cute. Woo, doggy. Cute and godly, what a great combination, huh? She's a little more open these days for me to suggesting guys. Early on, Dad, don't you know, what are you doing? But now she, you know, if I were to meet a guy here that was single and I was impressed with him, she would actually now let me talk, you know, let me tell you about this guy. But her first question, I hate to say it, how secular and immature and shallow? She goes, well, Dad, is he cute? You know, my evaluation of cuteness is probably different than you single ladies in the crowd, right? But see, we have five children. KK is the number five, but I love them all the same, friends. But my love for KK is a little bit different. You see, the first four, it's like, I brought you into this world, I can take you out, right? But see, I chose KK. I chose her to bring her into our family. And you know, for the last 25 years, you know what I've been catching myself doing? I've been catching myself wooing her. You know that word? Wooing her every day, you know, hoping that she will choose me back. You see, when she texts me wanting to go out to lunch with me, my heart just soars. Oh, my word, you know, you name it, and she got me wrapped around her little finger, you know. But when she says she doesn't have time to hang out, my heart is pierced. Oh, I have a happy face. Oh, no problem, KK, no problem. Inside, I'm dying, you know. Thank you. But isn't that true about our relationship with God? Think about it, friends. He only had one son. The rest of us are adopted. Okay? The Lord has emotions too. Jesus showed us that. He experiences joy and sorrow and as well as grief. And so each day we have a choice, don't we? He's chosen you. If you're a Christian here today, he's chosen you. You know what he's waiting on each day? He's waiting for you to choose him. I'm not talking about receiving Christ every day, you know, I'm going to pray a little prayer every day. No, I'm talking about choosing him to be your heavenly Father, your Lord, your master today. And when you choose to draw close to him, he derives great pleasure. I know he does, and joy. But when we ignore and reject him, do this to him, right? He grieves. As you can tell, I've learned a lot about the fatherhood of God, you know, through adopting, and KK has too. She will tell people she's been adopted twice. People go, oh, I'm so sorry. No, she goes, no, that's good. I was adopted by this family, but also by God. It's a chance to witness, right? So each day, as an adopted child of God, you can bring joy to the heart of God by choosing Him, choosing to draw close today. And that bond you have with the Lord will be deepened day by day. Now, as we go back over these excellent messages on living the dream, it seems like the main theme boiled down to, we really don't understand, do we? Or even believe or embrace what our Heavenly Father has done for us or stated about us. So I wanted to add this added obstacle this morning that keeps us, I think, from really experiencing God's dream. May I add one? This dream for our life, the abundant life that Jesus came, and it's fear. This idea of fear. We all have fear. Can we all admit that? We all admit that we are afraid. We tend to move towards those things that are safe and comfortable, right? And we move away from those things that are scary and intimidating. And so if we can start off by admitting that we all have fears, the question is, what are we going to do about them, right? Will we let them control us? Or will we walk towards our fears in the power of the Holy Spirit? It's a choice we have every day. So we can experience this life and the next and all that God has in store for us. We can live His dream. But we've got to understand these fears that seem to plague us. And the two we're going to touch on this morning is this idea of being afraid of God, and secondly, being afraid of others. Being afraid of what God is going to do in your life, and being afraid of others, primarily what they're going to think of us. So we're going to jump into that, okay? Let's make a distinction. The fear of God is a good thing. I don't mean to say that's not. It talks about it all through the Bible. And when we fear God, we have a respect and an awe for Him, a holy awe, and it causes us to obey Him. So the fear of God is biblical, and we should all have it. But being afraid of God is a little different, isn't it? It's a little different. It's when we're afraid to connect with Him. We hide from Him, and we're afraid to be honest with Him. We're afraid to turn over every area of our life. We're hiding little areas from Him. We have areas of our life that we want to hang on to. And when we're afraid of Him, we really don't trust Him. Trust Him with our life. We're not sure He has our best interests at heart. We don't give Him total control or allow Him to sit on the throne of our heart. When we're afraid of God, we don't trust Him as our Father. And we're afraid of surrendering our dreams to His dreams. Wouldn't that be a great thing for you to do this morning? You all have dreams. All of you have dreams. That's not bad. But they're so small and pitiful and in some ways even pathetic, aren't they, compared to God's dream for our life. What if we are to put our dreams in His hands and He gives us His dream? And so we relate to God sometimes, I think, like we're playing poker. My sons got into poker, Pastor, at some stage in their life. I think they watched a little too much ESPN Texas Hold'em, you know. And but you know, you got these five cards. And sometimes I think the Christian life, as it relates to God, we hold our cards really close to our chest. And these are our five cards, you know. And he wants us to lay a card down. You know, I'd like for you to, you know, come and commit to a good local church. I don't know. I'm busy. I'm kind of cool. You know, are the girls pretty? You know, I mean, okay, you play a card, you know. Well, we want you to, you know, get into a Bible study and start studying the Word every week and start to recruit your dorm mates to be in a Bible study. And a Bible study in my dorm every week? I mean, okay, I'll play a card, you know. Well, an internship. I mean, once I graduate, I mean, I'm going off to make $1 million. Don't talk to me about sticking around, you know, the city and, you know, working with college students, you know. You play that card, you know. And so it is agonizing to give up one of these things. And yet at some point, I'm praying that each of you at some point would lay all your cards down, would push all your chips in and say, I'm all in. I'm all in. You know, at ESPN now, they push it all in and they stand up for some reason. They kind of go like this, you know. Not that I've ever played poker myself, you know. But God truly does have our best interests at heart, friends. You can trust Him. You can trust Him. There was a recent college grad years ago named Luther Wishart. You might write that down and look him up. He's one of my heroes. He wanted to be used by God. He got down on his knees one day in the snow in Massachusetts. Do y'all know what snow is, by the way? Have you ever seen snow? Or it's kind of cool. But he got down on his knees and he prayed a profound prayer. Listen to this prayer that Luther Wishart, he was a recent graduate of college, wanted to be used by God, got down on the snow on this particular college campus there in Massachusetts, and he prayed this prayer. He said, "Lord, I'll go anywhere at any time to do anything for you." Wow, a pretty short prayer, but a powerful one, right? And he meant it, friends. He meant it, and God knew that he meant it, and young Luther got up from his knees and he launched the greatest missions mobilization movement in all of history. It's called the Student Volunteer Movement. And 100,000 college students across our nation during this time, it was the 1880s through the 1920s. Sorry to be, operating 100 years ago, but I want you to start having some heroes. You can tell a lot about a person by who your hero is. I hope it's not, you know, Beyonce. As great as, you know, singer she is, have heroes that have really sold their lives out for Christ, okay? Please let those be your heroes. So you've never heard of Luther Wishart, why don't you look him up, you know, and say, man, could this be one of my heroes? And so he got up and he was involved in recruiting 100,000 students who signed a declaration that they would commit their life to foreign missions, to cross-cultural missions, to reach the world for Christ. One out of every 37 students during that time in the history of our country signed that declaration. Isn't that amazing? Could we have a second student volunteer movement sometime? We need some Luther Wishards to rise up and take responsibility for that. Well, what about that prayer, friends? I think it'd be hard to really pray that prayer, wouldn't it? It's hard for me. All three of these areas are tough for me to think about and to really mean as I pray. But so how about that first one? Lord, I'll go anywhere. Could you pray that prayer? Lord, I'll go. You put your finger on that world map, Lord. You tell me where you want me to move. I'll obey. The second one, Lord, anytime. Lord, my agenda is no longer my agenda, my schedule, my calendar. You know, I don't have to, you know, graduate first or get married first or whatever my little plans are. No, I'm pushing it all in. And now my calendar is your calendar. My agenda is yours. My timeline is yours. Could you pray that prayer? Really mean it? Really give that to the Lord? How about that third one? Lord, I'll do anything for you. Dang, these are hard prayers to pray and really mean that. What if you decided you were going to pray that prayer? You might write that prayer down. I mean, this is a dangerous prayer, friends, very dangerous. I mean, what if the Lord kind of wanted you to pray that prayer? He kind of was kind of wooing you, kind of coaxing you to pray that prayer, you know? He's kind of luring you in to pray, you know? And so he's saying, okay, come on, get started. Come on now, get started. Okay, Lord, I'm praying. Lord, I'll go anywhere for you. Come on, keep coming. Okay, Lord, I'll do it anytime you say. Come on, keep praying. And Lord, I'll do anything for you, anywhere, anytime, anything. Amen. And some of us think if we really pray that prayer, then the Lord will go, aha, I got you now. I'm going to ruin your life. I'm going to send you to some desolate and desperate tribe in Africa and just destroy your life. No, I don't think he wants to destroy your life. He's got your best interests at heart, I promise you. And if you don't always understand God's hand, you can always trust his heart. You don't need to be afraid of what God wants to do in you and through you, right? You can trust your heavenly Father. And so Isaiah 41:10 was one of my favorite verses all through college and beyond. Listen to it. It says, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." That's a good verse for you to apply, you college students, right? You ever need God's righteous right hand to hold you up? Yeah, he loves you. He has your best interests at heart. He has a plan for you. So what areas of your life are you afraid to give over to God? Have you thought about that? I mean, totally. Are you hiding some little area? You've given the whole house and every room in that house, but you've locked this little closet upstairs. You've got the key to it, you know. Lord, you can have any area of the house you want. I mean, it's all yours. And he goes, no, I want that little room, that little closet up there and upstairs too. Oh, no, that's my room, Lord, you know. Everything else is yours, you know. What is it to you? Is it how you spend your money? Maybe how you spend your time? Maybe it's a certain dating relationship. Maybe it's what you view on the internet or social media. Maybe it's about your future, your dreams. I don't know. I remember when I was in college, I was dating a girl. She was a Christian girl. I was a freshman in college. But our relationship was not Christ-centered. The Lord kept pressing me to give her up, but I would not do it. And so I became more and more miserable until I finally had the courage to do it. And I remember when I finally did it, I went into a dark classroom in a building next door to our fraternity house there, and I cried for 3 hours. I'm not a crier. I wish I was, but I'm not. But emotions were just pouring out. It wasn't because I was sad. I was full of joy. I was finally set free. This 100-pound weight off my shoulders. It's not about the girl. I'm free of the girl. I'm not talking about that. No, I was finally free to follow Christ fully. Everything was his. And my spiritual life just zoomed straight up. It took off. And friends, I'm not saying you should do this, but then I made a decision the rest of my college years that I was going to work on my relationship with God, build a strong, deep, enduring foundation. I was going to learn how to build strong warrior kind of bonds with other Christian men, learn how to build Christian friendships with girls before I ever started another romance. Please go through that process. Don't jump straight to the romance, please. You'll wish you hadn't. That's for the next time about the relationship talk. I'll save that one, Pastor. Well, God did some amazing building in my life those next 3 or 4 years in college, and it lasted for a lifetime. So what does God want? He wants our mind, our soul, our body. He wants everything. He created us and already owns us. Right now, he's just waiting every single day to choose him. Will you choose me today? It's like he is holding out his hand to us. And he says, and we've got a little nickel. I'll use a money illustration now, okay? I've got my little nickel. And God says, if you'll just put your little nickel in my hand, I'll give you $1 million in return. I'm not talking about money here. I'm talking about our little life, right? Our little plans, our little dream. No, it's my little nickel. I can't let it go. It's the only nickel I've got. If you'll just put that in my hand, just put it in my hand and trust me, I will give you something in exchange that will just so far, you know, exceed what you could ever possibly think or imagine, okay? And so God has a plan and dream for you. Let go of our pitiful and pathetic little nickels, friends. It doesn't amount to anything in light of what he has for you. So maybe ask yourself these two questions in your quiet time tomorrow, okay? Number one, if God were to have his total way in your life, what would it look like? His total way. And secondly, what if he were to have his total way at your university or at your home or workplace? What would that look like? Will you think about that maybe? Sort of asking yourself those questions? The second area we want to touch on is this idea of being afraid of others. Afraid of others. Not only are we afraid of God at times, but we fear others, don't we? What they will think of us or say about us. And peer pressure and fear of rejection is so powerful. It is for teenagers, but man, it keeps going throughout life, I've noticed. College students, I thought adults, no, we've kind of matured beyond peer pressure and fear of rejection. No, I'm telling you, friends, it's even stronger and stronger as you go on. We've got to acknowledge that. We try to fit in, don't we, to go along, to get along, just try to blend in and become like everyone else. Dr. Larry Crabb wrote a great book called Encouragement. He says, we all tend to live our lives based upon fears. Do you want to live your life based upon fear? Perfect love casts out fear, is what 1 John tells us. How do we conquer that? Well, I think one of the areas we're afraid to do is to share our faith. We're afraid to share our testimony with people. We're afraid to share the gospel with people. I don't know if you've ever looked at this verse before, but Revelation 12:11 is a powerful verse, and I believe the context is that the 12 is talking about the 12 disciples overcoming Satan, the enemy, and this is how they did it. Okay, and they overcame him because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their testimony, and they did not love their life even unto death. And so I think right there it's telling you how the disciples had spiritual victory. The blood of the Lamb, that's the gospel, friends, okay? Do you know the gospel? Do you know how to share the gospel? There are people in this church that could teach you how to share the gospel in the same amount of time it takes you to study for one of your tests, okay? To know how to share the gospel, but also, secondly, your personal testimony of how you came to Christ. And so, please work on those two tools. That's how they overcame Satan. That's how they lived the God's dream. That's how you and I can start to really be used of God, okay? And so, don't be afraid to broach that subject with people out on campus or wherever you are, to start to share your testimony, to share the gospel, all right? And so, I love to ask people the golden question. The golden question. Well, it's the most life-changing question that anyone can be asked in any language. Can I tell you what the question is? It's a hard one to ask. It's challenging. Well, I mean, even to be able to get it out of my throat is so dry even thinking about this question. I need a little confidence here as I get it out. Here it is. Well, as I've shared my testimony with someone, as I've shared the gospel with someone, we've talked about it, answered their questions. You know, now it's kind of time to, you know, possibly ask them, you know, if they would like to make a decision. But it's hard to do, isn't it? I mean, my heart is bleeding like this. You know, I can barely keep my eyes on them. You know, I want to look away. And then my throat starts to get really dry. Well, Kurt, it's good being with you today. I just was wondering, Kurt, if you wanted to, you don't have to. Would you like to consider maybe, possibly, you know, this idea of, you know, putting your trust and faith into Jesus, you know, Jesus Christ, as your Savior, as your Lord, maybe even today. And then the toughest part is what? To zip the lip, right? Isn't that tough? 'Cause now you want to review and realign and add in and amplify and no, just ask them the question. It's the most powerful question you could ever ask a human being on this planet. Friends, you might risk the relationship, sorry, but it truly shows that you love that person. I don't think they're going to ever be asked that question by any other person during their 60, 70, 80 years on this life. If you just spend your life lovingly, relationally, asking the golden question of those around you and then have enough courage and love and dignity and honor that you're extending them to zip the lip and let them answer. Only in heaven will you see what kind of impact you've had on this earth. You go, well, Steve, I don't like that awkwardness. What if there's a second or two or three where I'm looking at them and they're looking at me? You know, friends, sometimes awkward questions change lives, okay? And so if there is some silence, sorry about that. But they are thinking, they're evaluating, they know it's their turn to talk. And in those two or three seconds of awkward silence, the Holy Spirit, there's never a point in the time of their 70 years on this earth where the Holy Spirit has more opportunity to bring divine tension onto their life than after you ask the golden question of someone. It's true. And so, if you care about someone's soul, you're probably the only one that really cares about their soul. See, if you say you love someone, but you don't care about their soul, what are you really saying? I think you're saying, I like his appearance. I like his personality. I like his sense of humor. You know, I like the way he, you know, hits the softball. I don't know, you know, what is it you like about him? Do you care about people's souls? You really don't love them if you don't care about their soul. And so, friends, think about asking that question, spending your life asking that question. Okay, I'm going to spend the rest of my life risking the relationship, showing people just how much I love them, just how much I care for their soul. And I'm willing to risk everything to let them answer. And this was Timothy's struggle when he was in big bad Ephesus, as he was had been left there by his pastor, mentor of 17 years, the Apostle Paul. Paul was sitting in a Roman prison about to be beheaded by Nero there. And he was writing his final letter to his young disciple, Timothy, there in this incredibly secular city called Ephesus. And Timothy was young, he was single, he was timid, and he was afraid. And he said to Timothy, he's trying to give him some backbone. He said, Timothy, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and discipline. That's what God has given you. He doesn't want fear to control you. He's given you power, love, and discipline instead. So if you're a college student here this morning, don't be afraid to live a different life than those around you, okay? Really and truly. I remember the place where I was on the college campus where I decided to become one person. I'd been two persons. To my non-Christian buddies, fraternity brothers, I was kind of acting cool and had a different lingo and, you know, different activities. And with my Christian friends, I, praise the Lord, what can I pray for you, sister? You know, and, you know, occasionally I got it mixed up. I'd say, you know, I'd say to my, praise the Lord, brother, what can, oops, that's the wrong group, you know. I remember when I, where exactly I was when I was walking across that University of Arkansas campus. I think I was a sophomore in college. Well, I decided in my heart, I'm going to be one person, not two. I'm going to be one person. And that person is going to totally identify with Jesus Christ. Unashamedly, unashamedly, not in an arrogant, proud way, in a humble, unashamed way, I'm one person. I am a child of God. And I am an ambassador for Jesus Christ. Maybe you need to pray that prayer to become one person, not two. Are you somebody different at church here than you are the rest of the week? You need to become one person, one person. And so, gang, I have a definition of college. College is a four-year window in a person's life when God has maximum opportunity to build a foundation into a life lived by Him. I don't know how much time you have. I extended 4 years into six just so I could really build a good foundation, right? My dad was not too thrilled. And so you're building a foundation right now, and the depth of that foundation, how deeply you build that foundation now in college is going to depend upon what kind of structure you're going to have during this life. Maybe you just want to be a little bungalow for Jesus in your life, little hut for Jesus. Well, then you don't really need to build much of a foundation, right? If you want to become a skyscraper for Jesus Christ, a giant oak tree for Him, you're going to have to spend time now, prioritizing, saying no to a lot of lesser things now to dig, and build that invisible foundation infrastructure in your heart and your life. Are you willing to do that? Yeah. Some of you will, some of you won't. So why are you at college? You thought about that? Well, maybe your parents wanted you to come, your girlfriend wanted you to come. But what if I was having a conversation with you and I say, Kirk, why are you at college? Well, I want to get a good education and degree. Well, why do you want to get a good education and degree, Kirk? Well, so I can get a good job. Well, Kirk, why do you want a good job? Well, I'd like to have a good salary. Well, Kurt, why do you want a good salary? Well, I can kind of see where you're going with this, Steve. I guess I confess that I'd like to get a good education so I can get a good job, so I can get a good salary, so I can, you know, you know, live the kind of comfortable, you know, easy lifestyle that I've always dreamed of living, kind of the American dream that our politicians are promising us all, you know. That's kind of where I'm headed. Is that evil, Steve? Did I say something wrong, you know? Well, that's so typical. I mean, it's so normal, right, for virtually every American, for sure. One of the men I respect, an author and pastor, Walt Hendrickson, he said, if you are at college for any other reason but to be a missionary for Jesus Christ, you're there for sinful, selfish reasons. Whoa, I'm glad he said that. I didn't say that. You're going to blame him and not me. But if you backtrack my little conversation with Kurt, you can kind of see why he says that, right? If I'm here so that someday it's all about me. I want the big house. I want the cars. I want the vacations. I want the comfort, the conveniences of life, the luxury. Yeah. Yeah. We're here for our own purposes. What if you were to switch that, friends? Said, I'm here in college to primarily grow in Christ, build that deep foundation, and leave a legacy of people behind me that really, really know Christ. So don't go to college or do anything in order to please others, but to please God. And this is, again, what Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy, the next chapter, chapter 2. He said, suffer hardship with me, Timothy, as a good soldier in Christ Jesus. No soldier in active service entangles himself in the affairs of everyday life. Why? So that he may please the one who enlisted as a soldier. Okay? So be a pleaser, friends, but a God pleaser, not a man pleaser. He chose you to be a pleaser of him. And so college students, I've noticed, focus on the four S's. Will you write these down? I hope you're involved in at least one of these. I think you are. Studies, sports, social, and surfing. Now, surfing is not this kind of surfing, you know, on the Pacific coast. I'm talking about the whole internet, social media. Now that I'm on Instagram, and sometimes it'll tell me how many hours this week I spent on. Do you all have that little function? I wish I could turn that off. I mean, X number of hours. You got to be kidding me. I spent that many hours. Yes. Don't tell me you don't have time for church or Bible study or ministry or anything else when you look at the number of hours you were surfing. Right? And so a lot of people are the four S's. Those are not evil, but God has said nothing about them. I'd like for you to focus on the four W's. Will you consider this? The Word, worship, witness, and the world, reaching the world for Christ. You see, most Christian schedules are packed with the four S's, and they might squeeze in a W or two here, you know, here or there. What if you were to switch that and say, I'm going to commit to the things God is very clear about, not the things he's totally silent about. It's not bad to go to college, but I just haven't found in the Bible any place where it says go to college or make a 4.0. No. What if you were to lock your schedule, build it in each week with the worship and the word and the witness and the world, and now you have discretionary time that you can fill in with these other areas like school and et cetera. It's a Matthew 6:33 person seeking first the kingdom of God. That's what it's all about, okay? So let me ask you some questions and start to kind of wind this down if we can. Thank you for your patience with me. I regularly ask myself some questions, friend. You might want to do this tomorrow morning. What is my life objective? What is my life goal? Do you have one? Maybe even come up with a life verse. Galatians 2:20 is one that I love to hang on to. What's your go-to verse when you're struggling, when you're tempted, when you just can't, you know, you got to have a verse to hang on to, cling to, your go-to verse. Maybe that's your life objective, your North Star. Philippians 4:10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. Maybe that's a good one for you. How about this second question? Am I fulfilling the Great Commission, the final commands that Jesus gave to us before he ascended? Just this past week, it was the 5-year anniversary of my father's passing at age 90. It was the greatest honor of my life to help him in his final years, his final months, his final weeks, his final days, his final moments. To be there to help him transition from this life to the next, nothing compares. Well, excuse me. Final words are important, friends. Final words are important. The final words that Jesus gave us need to be the first words in our heart. To go and make disciples of all the nations. You might write down Acts 1:8. That was his final commission about being witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost parts. There are people in this church that can help you start to fulfill the Great Commission. Number three, am I being strategic for the kingdom? Okay, are you living strategically? There are kind of three kinds of Christians I've noticed over the years. There's busy Christians, where they're just busy, busy, busy with all kinds of activities and concerts and prayer meetings and, you know, the soup kitchen and the Bible study and the fellowship group, and they just run around like a chicken with their head cut off, you know? And they somehow feel important if their schedule is full of busy Christian activities, but they're really not heading anywhere. Then there's the next category. There's effective. No effective Christians. They've narrowed down a few things, so they're kind of focused on a few things. They're making some more progress. But I want you to become, I think God wants you to become that third category of being strategic. Strategic. Not a shotgun, but more of a rifle feel, more narrow feel, right? Where you're going to say no to everything else except, yes, this is God's calling in my life. This is God's dream for my life. And you're going to focus on that and say no to everything else, okay? And so when you graduate, I'd ask these two questions if I were you. Where can I live? What church or ministry can I plug into in order to get the best teaching and training I possibly can? What if you were to make that your number one priority? Above, well, should I take the Dell offer in Austin for $60,000 or should I take the, you know, Google offer in Palo Alto for $65,000? You know, I like the climate up there, but, you know, that's how most graduates make their decisions on jobs. What if you were to turn that on its head? And said, no, I want to go where I can continue to be taught and trained and prepared to be God's man, God's woman. Second question you might ask yourself is this, where can I go and live and study and work in the world to have the greatest impact for Christ possible? You keep asking yourself those two questions throughout your life, friends, you're going to live a very strategic life, very good strategic life. In fact, that verse that we just quoted that Paul was writing to Timothy about being a good soldier, I'm no Greek scholar. You know, I think I've had eight Greek courses, Pastor, but I'm not sure I could tell you eight Greek words right now. Can y'all think of a Greek word for me? Anybody? What is it? Well, see, I have no idea what that means, see? Huh? Hoopa? Hoopa. See, I've forgotten it all. But this word, I'll tell you what it is. The word soldier means stratalogeos. It's a word about strategy. Soldiers have a strategy. They have a plan. And so if you're a good soldier in Christ Jesus, you've got a strategy to fulfill the Great Commission. That's how I can tell, someone can tell whether you've taken personal responsibility is whether you have a strategy, a plan. I know you have strategies. You students have study and homework and test-taking strategies, okay? Some of you have some fitness strategies. You know, I'm doing, today is my leg day. You know, I'm doing legs. And tomorrow's my, you know, upper body day. And got to have, you know, 89,000 grams of protein today, you know. And, you know, you barely can walk around, you know. Some of you ladies, you know, have a suntanning strategy, I think, you know, and dating strategies, right? Some of you, your fathers, I'll bet you, they're spending every day, you know, they're tweaking their little stock portfolio every single day, and they got this strategy, you know. Oh, we have all kinds of strategies, but we don't have one with the central one, the major on the majors of the Great Commission. And so I challenge you to have a strategy, okay? His dream for your life, not just yours. So let me finish with a story. I was at a men's conference recently. 104-year-old Navy veteran was sitting there in a wheelchair. He was one of the final veterans. Only two were left. They were on the ships at Pearl Harbor, December 1941. There he was sitting at the front of the room. By himself. Then a 75-year-old man comes up and stands next to him. And he says, he started to describe how this 104-year-old veteran won him to Christ and discipled him. But this veteran looked at him one day and he said, "Don't you be the last link in this chain." Well, then after that, a 64-year-old man came up and stood next to the 75-year-old man. And told him how that 75-year-old man had led him to the Lord and spent years discipling him, and how the thing that man kept repeating to him over and over was what? Don't you be the last link in this chain, this discipleship chain. Well, next, Larry, a friend of mine, a 50-year-old man, walked up and stood next to that 64-year-old man. He started describing how that man had discipled and trained him, but always it seemed like at the end of their time, he would say what to him? Don't you be the last link in this chain, Larry. Finally, a 21-year-old college student came up to stand next to my friend Larry. And he told us how Larry had started a Bible study on the baseball team and took him out and shared the gospel with him and led him to Christ and spent the last 2 years pouring into him. And with tears in his eyes, Brandon, this young man, he said, "I had no idea the chain was so long. And it had remained unbroken all these years." And so when Larry told me, "Brandon, don't you be the last link in this chain," I can see her clear. I can see clearly now what he means. And he turned to Larry and he said, God has given me a man, Larry. Finally, God has given me a man that I am starting to disciple. And I promise you, he will not be the last link in this chain. You may not realize it, friends, but you're a link in someone's chain. You know that? Determine today that you are not going to be the last link, that you're going to spend your life adding links, adding links, adding links, so you can look back on your life without regret, knowing that you left a legacy. Not how much money you made, not a resume full of activities or achievements, but flesh and blood, human beings. They're going to know Christ and make him known throughout this world as a result of your life. That'd be God's way. That'd be God's dream. That'd be living the dream God's way, wouldn't it? Let me pray for us. Lord Jesus, we feel so inadequate. We have so many fears, so many questions. The world feels like it's squeezing us into its mold. There's an enemy that's trying to kill us and destroy us. We have no hope in our own strength. There's nothing we can do in and of ourselves to have victory, God. The only way that we can overcome all these challenges, these obstacles, these blockades, these fears, is to fix our eyes on you and say, we're going to believe what you have said about us, not the world. We're going to become this child of God, filled with the Holy Spirit, walk towards our fears in the power of the Holy Spirit, and to become all that you want us to. We're going to lay our dreams down, and we're going to take your dream fully. Please give us grace. Give us anointing. Give us your power to be and to do all that you've called us to be and to do. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
You know, let's just stay in this moment for a second. I want to pray again. In fact, would you guys do me a favor? Put all your notes down for a second. Let's just stand up together. Stand up together. Such a great message.
Thank you,
Steve.
Thank you.
Such a great story. So many good stories. I feel like the Lord wants to do a transaction before we leave. What do you guys think? You know, Romans 8:15 says, for you have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you've received a spirit of adoption as sons by which we cry out, Abba, Father, which means in Greek, Daddy, Daddy. I was so gripped by Steve's story about KK. He said, we adopted her, we chose her, but we've spent the rest of our lives wanting her to choose us back. And she has. Just wonder, as we close, if you know you're chosen. You know God's put his hand on you. You know that he is kindness in Romans 2:4. It says the kindness of God leads us to repentance. Maybe you know you're being led to a relationship with Jesus, but maybe you haven't chosen him yet. So what we're going to do is we're going to sing a song here together, because what I think happens sometimes when we sing is we just release the tension. We just release this sense of, what is my problem? I'm just looking at myself. I'm looking at what I can do and all the things I've done or haven't done and all this. I'm just going to look up and I'm going to look at Abba Father and I'm going to say, release me from my fears. Being afraid to trust Jesus, being afraid of other people and what they think. What do you say? What if we did right now? What would happen in our lives today if we let those fears go? What do you think? I mean, would our lives be better? I know mine would. Would our lives be better? And so we have a couple of musicians here. They're going to lead us. We're going to sing this song. I'm going to pray quickly. We're going to sing this song. I'm going to enter into worship myself for just a few minutes here, and I'm going to come back up and pray to close us. But let me pray first. Lord, thank you for this moment. It's not a coincidence that we're here. None of us just happened to come here without divine influence. Thank you for sending Steve Shadrach and this message. Your word has come alive to us in a new way. Father, we are chosen by you. We're redeemed by the Son. And we are sealed by the Holy Spirit. If we've said yes to choose you. And so during this song, Lord, I want us to count the cost. If we haven't made that decision to say yes back to Jesus, to choose him, to choose to put the full weight of our trust in Christ alone as Lord and Savior, let this song be that moment where we count the cost and let those fears go. And then I'm going to come back up and pray. Lord, I believe you're going to meet some people, all of us, in salvation, and those that are already saved in transformation. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's sing together. Let's sing together. Praise God.
Sing together. I'm no longer a slave to fear. You guys ready?
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. Unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemy. Till all my fears are gone.
I'm no longer.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child.
From my mother's womb.
From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name.
Sing it out, come on.
I've been born again to your family. Your blood flows through.
I'm no longer.
I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Come on.
I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child.
I'm no longer.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Come on, let's lift our hands. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child.
Out.
time. Oh, 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 I am surrounded.
Come on, shout! Praise you, Jesus. Just keep the music going. You know, we have a messed up definition of freedom. We think freedom means do whatever you want to do, but freedom is really do what you were created to do. We were created for God. We were created to be part of His family. And Scripture says that we were born dead in our transgressions. In other words, every one of us, our biggest problem is that we are born physically alive but spiritually dead. We have bios, biological life, but we don't have zoe, which is spiritual life. That's why Jesus said when He came on earth, you must be born again. With your heads bowed today, there are some people here that you have been asking yourself, what is my problem? And the Holy Spirit's telling you, you're not part of my family. I want you to be part of my family. I want you to be born again. He's chosen you. His kindness has led you to repentance. Just like you can lead a horse to water, you can't make him drink. No one can make you repent and surrender your life to Jesus. But when the grace is there, when you sense that today's my day, I'm going to go all in. I'm pushing all the chips in the middle. I'm putting everything in the middle. I'm all in. When Jesus died on the cross, he was 100% all in. He was all in. He was completely surrendered to his Father's will, and he was completely committed to saving and rescuing us. And the question the Holy Spirit's asking you today is, are you willing to surrender control of your life and your fears? Your fear, being afraid of what God might call you to do or what God might call you to give up, are you willing to surrender that to the God who created you, to the God who knows you, the God who has numbered the hairs on your head? He's formed you in your mother's womb, and he's asking, will you give your life back to me? I created you. I chose you. But I'm asking, will you choose me back? And there are a few people here today, and I'm not going to have you come up or do anything, really. I'm going to ask you, this is between you and God. If you make this decision now, everybody will know it eventually. And I encourage you to tell someone today so that they can help you build that foundation that Steve talked about. There's a few in this room today, and you know who you are. You have been around the gospel. You've had close encounters with Jesus, but you've never had a personal encounter. And you know that he's knocking on the door of your heart, and you know today's your day. You're going to go all in. And so pray with me this prayer silently in your heart as I pray it. Jesus, thank you for living the life I should have lived and dying the death that I should have died in my place. Thank you for rising from the dead 3 days later, proving that you're God and offering salvation to me today on the basis of repentance and faith. You did the heavy lifting, and now you're saying, will you choose me? And I choose you, Jesus. I choose to put the full weight of my trust in you alone for my salvation. I can't save myself. I can't make myself better. I have to be saved by you. And in making that decision, I don't just accept your salvation. I accept you as Lord of my life, and I let go of any fears of you running my life because you created me. And it's the best life, the dream is when you live your life through me. And so I just say, I surrender, Jesus. Take my life. Take my life. You can be Lord and Savior of my life. And Holy Spirit, give me the power now, as I'm born again in this moment, to follow you. And when I fall short, to come back again and again and again and choose you. Help me to have men and women in my life that will disciple me, a local church and a relationship with your word that I could build a foundation, and that any other fears that are in my life that you would deliver me of those. But today I choose you because I know you chose me and you died for me. You did everything. Now I choose you back. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, I really want you to tell somebody so they can help you. For the rest of us, man, was there some transaction that happened during that song? Come on, we are free. Praise God. Praise God. Let me pray for the rest of us as we leave. Lord, thank you for the rest of everyone here that maybe they've already made that decision or they're still counting the cost. Lord, as we leave here, we want to leave free. You said, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. And Lord, you've set us free by your Holy Spirit, free of fear of what people think. Lord, I was so afraid of what my friends thought in my fraternity when I gave my life to you. And you delivered me and made me unashamed of the gospel. Like Steve said, you made me one person, not two. I used to be two as well. For the rest of us as we leave here, help us to be one person as we leave here. We would follow after you, Jesus, and love our friends into the kingdom of God. Lord, give us such a passion for them that we would lay down our lives to see them come into your kingdom, Lord. Thank you for this day. Thank you for everyone. Bring us back next week. And thank you for our brother in Christ who came all the way from Arkansas to bless us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wasn't that awesome, guys? Hey, so, I mean, let's give another hand. That was pretty great. So what really spoke to me was the difference between having a fear of God, which is good, and being afraid of God. So I'm really looking forward to processing how I can continue connecting with God as my Father in my Connect groups this week.
That's good, yeah. And if you guys want prayer for anything, we're going to have a team up here after service. But other than that, that's all we have for you guys. Thanks for joining us today, and we'll see you next week.